Very good morning, cadets. Hope you are doing well. I hope you have gone through the last chapter. Today, let us discuss the chapter Making of National Movement, 1870s to 1947. Cadets, we are in the process of introducing the chapters or the syllabus for the academic year 2021-22, and we are taking an activity of briefly introduction or introducing the chapters. I told you earlier there were two textbooks, history, that is part 1 and part 2, and 12 chapters were there. Now only one textbook and 10 chapters is there. So this is chapter number 9. Okay, this soft copy of textbook, it is of old one. So this is, consider this is chapter number 9. Now this chapter is very important, not only in class 8. You have to remember this chapter because the reference of this chapter is there even in the higher classes. That in class 10th also we discuss about the nationalism in India, the chapter. Now what do you mean by national movement? Whenever we speak about national movement, this is a reference to the freedom movement in India. Cadets, you know very well, Indian National Congress was an organization. What today what you are seeing, the political party, that Congress and Indian National Congress are different. Indian National Congress was established or formed by A.O. Hume in 1885. Later, the Indian National Congress fought or organized movements against the British government, and under the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi and other great leaders, India attained freedom in the year 1947. So in this chapter we are discussing about the important national events from the period of 1870s to 1947. Hope you understood what I am explaining. So in the previous chapters, what we studied, the previous chapter that we studied, that British conquest of territories and takeover of kingdoms, this we studied in the case of ruling countryside and from trade to territory, that is chapter number 2. That of course I briefly introduced. When we studied detail, we'll go through that. So British East India Company taken over the administration in India after the Battle of Buxar, that is 1764, and they got the Diwani of Bengal in the year 1765. The second point, introduction of new laws and administrative institutions. So the British started the system of administration by introducing laws in India. Not only laws, they also started several administrative units. That is what another introduction by the British East India Company. The rules and regulations made by the British East India Company definitely affected the life of farmers and tribals. That is what we studied in the gone through the chapter called The Revolt of 1857, and the next chapter, that is Tribals, Dikus and Vision of Golden Age. So the rule of British East India Company affected peasants of the farmers and the tribals. Later, we studied about the civilizing natives and educating nation chapter. So, if you remember what we studied in the chapter, British projected that their rule in India is to civilize the Indian society and to educate Indians, not to exploit or not for their benefit. It is the benefit of Indians. That is what we are studied in briefly in the chapter. So then condition of women we studied, means briefly introduced the chapter called Women, Caste and Social Reforms. Caste system in India, social and religious reforms, various leaders like Swami Dayanand Saraswati, Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, Rajaram Mohan Roy, Pandita Ramabai, Begum Rokia Shekhawat Hussain, Swami Vivekananda, Sir Vivian Derajo. So, lot of information about the leaders. And of course, the revolt of 1857 and its impact. So, we gone through the entire process in apart from that, in this chapter we study about the emergence of nationalism in India. Nationalism means a feeling of oneness towards a particular nation. In India, the birth or emergence of nationalism was not so easy, because prior to British rule, India was ruled by several kings and of course kingdoms, and the people or the subjects, their obligation or they were responsible for their own kingdoms. For example, Marathas. For Marathas, the Wadars of Mysore were the enemies. For Marathas, Sikh were the enemies. Rajputs were the enemies. For Mughals, Marathas, Sikhs, Rajputs, rest all were enemies. So, in India, what today we see, the geographical area from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, or from Gujarat to Arunachal, this India is purely because of the British rule. Now, don't conclude that I am giving 100% mark for the British rule for uniting. It's not like that. British defeated almost all Indian kings. So when they defeated almost all Indian kings, for entire Indians, the enemy became common. Was the enemy? The British. That's the reason why Indians were united. So when we study about the concept of nationalism, so here we have to refer about irrespective of their class, color, caste, creed, language and or gender, and the country, its resources and the system were meant for all of them. With this answer came the awareness of that the British were exercising control over the resources of India and the lives of its people. And until this control was ended, India could not be for Indians. So that is what in this chapter we are going to discuss. We are also going to discuss about the birth of Indian National Congress. The Indian National Congress, this is not the Congress party of today's, this is an organization. The Indian National Congress was established when 72 delegates from all over the country met in Bombay in December 1885. Please remember the date. So, Indian National Congress, the formation of Indian National Congress, year 1885. So, leaders, who are the leaders? The early leadership of Indian National Congress, Dadabhai Nawroji, Firoz Shah Mehta, Badruddin Tyabji, Umesh Chandra Banerjee, that is W.C. Banerjee, Surendranath Banerjee, Romesh Chandra Banerjee, Chandra Dutt, Subramanya Iyer were top leaders. And the initiation was taken by the British, retired British official called A.O. Hume. So he played a major role in formation of Indian National Congress. So cadets, of course I'll explain detail when we discuss, but please remember the Indian National Congress was formed in the year 1885 by A.O. Hume and other 72 delegates from India. So please try to remember a few important names of early leaders of Indian National Congress. Later, the Indian National Congress, among the leadership, it was divided into various groups. So one group, they were called as moderates. The second, they were called as extremists. So moderates and extremists means there were few leaders who were not happy with the senior leaders of Indian National Congress. That's the reason why they were not happy to be part of moderate group. So few young leaders, they intensified the struggle or they intensified the movement against the British. Who are the top leaders in this? You may remember very popular name, that is Lal Bal Pal. Lal Bal Pal means Bipin Chandra Pal. Bipin Chandra Pal, Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Lala Lajpat Roy. Lala Lajpat Roy. So this trio are called as Lal Bal Pal. Now Lala Lajpat Roy, Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Bipin Chandra Pal, they were not happy with the senior leaders of Indian National Congress like Umesh Chandra Banerjee, Bal Gangadhar, the Surendranath Banerjee, W.C. Banerjee, Badruddin Tyabji. So senior leaders, of course, when we study detail, and that's the reason why these young leaders, they call themselves as radicals. So earlier group was called as moderates. Now what's the difference between moderates and radicals? Moderates, their way of fighting against the British was in a moderate way, like writing letters to the British by requesting facilities, doing petitions or requesting them, not intensified movement. Whereas radicals, the name itself suggests that they were extremes. That's the reason why they said that we should argue for the freedom of ours. That's the reason why the famous slogan of Bal Gangadhar Tilak, that is Swaraj. Swaraj means independence. He said that Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it. That is what the famous quote of freedom is my birthright and I shall have it. So in this chapter we are going to study about the split in the Indian National Congress between moderates and extremists, and of course after 1920 the leadership in Indian National Congress, there was a change. Mahatma Gandhi took the leadership and led the freedom movement. Apart from that, we are going to study how the national movement in India turned as mass nationalism. This is very important, that mass nationalism. If you observed Indian freedom movement in the initial days when it started after revolt of 1857, participation of people in the national movement was relatively not so high. Only the top leaders, they used to participate. But Gandhiji felt that Indian national movement should be a mass movement. Not only political leaders, it should be supported by everyone, like farmers, students, working people, women, everyone. That's the reason why Gandhiji devised several techniques in which he is successful in pulling the crowd. That's the reason why the slowly after 1920s the Indian national movement, it turned as a mass movement. So we are going to study that in this particular chapter. In the same chapter we are going to discuss about the influence of Mahatma Gandhi, advent of Mahatma Gandhi to India. So Mahatma Gandhi arrived in India in the year 1915 from South Africa at the age of 46. So Mahatma Gandhi was practicing barrister or law in South Africa, and because of the request of Gopal Krishna Gokhale, Gandhiji returned to India in the year 1915, and he led the people in a non-violent method. Okay, so non-violent method, he led lot of movement in South Africa against apartheid policy. So Gandhiji's influence in the Indian National Congress and how he led the Indian National Congress, that is also we are going to study in this particular chapter. So this is a painting of when Mahatma Gandhi arrived. So he is Mahatma Gandhi. Okay. From South Africa. So cadets, chapter the making of national movement is a very, of course, big chapter and very informative chapter. So that's the reason why even the introduction of this chapter I decided to make into part 1 and part 2. So part 1 we will stop with this, and part 2 in the next video session we'll continue. Please try to understand each and every chapter, means please have a bird's eye view or a chart related to the chapter, so that you will not miss out any major points from that particular chapter. So you have to learn any subject for a deeper level of understanding, not just for the sake of examination. Thank you. It's a wonderful day.